popular.
And then if you know your doctrine, then you understand some of the things that they're saying is not true, it's not biblical. Because a lot of times what they'll do, they'll mix scripture into their doctrine, and their doctrine will take you and lead you to their God. And it didn't come from no person. It was founded on Joseph, but it's not founded upon Jesus Christ. And anything that's not founded upon Jesus Christ, guess what it is? It's it is, and it's not doctrine. Let's read this. He said, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick, the word quick means the living, and the dead at his appearing, and his kingdom. The word kingdom there means God's ways and method of doing things. And if you don't know God's ways and method of doing things, which come out of here, then guess what? You are not actually operating in the kingdom of God. Because he said when he comes back, that he's coming back. Jesus is coming back. He said, will I find faith on this earth? And also he said, guess what? He said, at his appearance, he's going to judge the living and the dead. Now, the Bible says that when he went away into heaven to deposit all of his blood. Isn't that right? He said, because that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. Now, everybody in the world, which is being of people, could have shed all their blood and it still would not deliver one person. Only person that could deliver us by his blood was the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you were the only person that ever existed on this earth, Jesus would have still come, had to die, in order to give you a right to the tree of life by the shedding of his blood. Because without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. But now he went away as Lord and Savior in order to sit on the right hand of the Father to intercede for us and to give back the New Testament and send the Holy Ghost to comfort us and to lead us and to guide us. But when he comes back, he's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's coming back in the fury, in the judgment of the righteous God. Amen? So you want to make sure that you're in right standing with him regardless, because he said he's going to judge the dead and he's also going to judge the living. And I read in the scriptures, it says some men's sins go before them and then some men's sins come after them. So I don't know about you, I want to make sure that I'm under the blood. Because when I'm under the blood, the Father look at the blood and then see me through the blood. And when he sees me through the blood, he sees me as righteousness. He sees me in right standing. He sees me as a child of God. He sees me as his son, praise God. I'm no more just a son, but he sees me as a friend. Good God, Almighty God is such a good God. Isn't that right?
Amen.
Go to verse 2. Go read this. Verse 2, he said, preach the word. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke. Exhort with all long suffering and doctrine, right? He didn't tell me to tickle your flesh to make you feel good. Now, if you study the history of Jesus, if you look at the four synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, if you look at that, you see a lot of times Jesus offended a lot of people. And Jesus said, he said, I did not come to bring unity. He said, I come to separate the mother from the father, then the father from the son. He said, I came to separate. Because you will find in houses today, you will find a person that believes and a person that does not believe. Because the Bible said a house that divided against itself, it cannot stand. It said if the Satan himself beat against himself, he can't stand. Amen? So you want to make sure you're on the same page, on the same unity, and make sure that you're receiving the same word. So I'm going to show you some things today. And it's not everybody preaching the word. It's not everybody exhorting. It's not everybody that's rebuking. It's not everybody that had long suffering and teaching the doctrine of Jesus Christ. Amen. Y'all just bear with me. I'm doing the introduction right now. Amen. So go to verse 3. We'll teach you something today. You guys are my core group. And I know, guess what? See, you ready now to give you all that milk. And I know now you're ready for me. All right. So I'm going to pour out some. What's called that big steak? T-bone porterhouse, filet mignon. I'm gonna put all that stuff on you right now. Amen. Verse 3. It said, for the time will come. Say that name. Time will come.
Time will come.
When they means the Christian, the child of God.
Yeah.
This is written to Timothy, who Paul was a young man. He was a young man just like Mark back there. See, Mark Rogers, he's a young man. So young man like Mark. And what it did, Paul got him to be his son.
Yeah.
And Paul took him under his wing and to train and to teach him. But he took Timothy and signed him over a church. He became an elder and the pastor of a church. And Paul began to mentor him and to train him. And he told Timothy, which was the pastor of the Thessalonica church, he told him not to do these things and to do certain things so he could grow in the ministry. Amen?
Amen.
He said, they will not endure sound doctrine.
Yeah.
Sound doctrine. And what I tell you sound doctrine is the what? The word of God is sound doctrine. And he said, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. We're going to talk about that. Doctrine and itching ears. Go to verse 4. Hallelujah. And they shall turn away their ears, from the truth, and shall be turned into fables. Turn their ears away from the truth, and shall turn into fables. Now, itching ears means to feel restless or strong desire to do something. A hunger, a thirst, a why, a wish, a desire, a tickle, an eagerness to hear something new. Something new. Because I talked to several pastors in the area, right? And they told me one time, they said that Messiah, what's the favorite church you used to go to? The other church you used to go to? Overcomers, and I don't know all the churches here, but I talked to some of them. They said, used to be World Overcomer was the desired place for everybody to be. Then it says that, what's his name, that just got married? The older guy, Baptist Church. Mount Vernon's. Said that was nothing but the place to go in Mount Vernon's. Then it said New Direction was nothing but the place to go, where everybody go. And now, guess what? People are running from place to place to try to find some place that they can go to that they can feel comfortable so they can continue to live the way they want to live and have no teaching about it to go against what they're doing. That's what you call engineers. Uh-huh. Now, I want to do what I want to do, but I don't want no doctrine to tell me that it's wrong. Leviticus 18:22, put that on the board. I wasn't going to go there, but Holy Spirit, thank you for bringing it. Leviticus 18:22, glory to God. I wasn't going to read this. I wasn't going to say this, but I'm being led by the Holy Ghost. We pray, right? Amen. 18:22. It said, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is an abomination.
All right.
And what it is, abomination means that to disgust. Yeah. God hate that. And I read a book by A.E. Allen. A.E. Allen's whole ministry was dealing with demonic forces. A.E. Allen says that the homosexual spirit is so demons that is so nasty and so terrible looking and smells so bad that the rest of the demons don't want to have nothing to do with it.
All right.
He showed a picture of it in the book. I'll show y'all a picture of that one day that the Lord showed him. And he said it is foul. And it comes from Ephesians chapter 6. It comes from a spirit of power that it controls and take up your mind to think and make you think that you're a man. I mean, you're a man when you're a woman.
All right.
And you're a woman when you're a man. So that you know that's demonic. And the Bible says that's vile affection. And he said he gave them over to a reprobate mind. That's an evil mind. That they would do and say anything. And then that's what you find now. They are running from place to place to find a place that said that homosexuality is okay.
Uh-huh.
That's what you call what?
It's
your ears. That's not sound doctrine. But that right there is what? Sound doctrine. God said, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. He said, I change not. I don't care how many thousands or million people you see that's marching in the streets and saying we have deserved our rights. This is our right. That I'm going to do this. I came out the closet. I did this. God says that I am God. I change not. And he said he will come to judge the living and the dead at his appearance. Amen? Amen. Praise God. I'm teaching what? Doctrine.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Now go to Acts chapter 17. We're going to read verses 16 through 31. Y'all still love me?
Yeah.
If I don't tell you the truth, guess what? I'm not your pastor. The Bible says you got to be a good shepherd. He said you got to be a howling shepherd. Just come in and just get a sheep, anything, to fleece the sheep. And what I mean by fleece the sheep, you know what I mean? That's being merchandising the anointing. I come under the anointing, which is the word of God is anointing. And I come under the anointing, and the only thing I want from you is numbers so I can get your money. That's what's called merchandising the anointing. I'm not going to do that. Now watch this. Now Paul came to Mars Hill. Paul did. And he went and found some people, and guess what they was doing? They all had itching ears. They didn't want to deal with the sound doctrine of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, but they had itching ears. Now watch this. Watch this. This might point you to some people that you know. He said, now when Paul waited for them in Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given over to what? Idolatry. Idolatry. Can I bring it home? The most powerful spirit that you find right now over the city of Memphis is idolatry. People worshiping all kinds of things. And that's why you find murder, rape, stealing. You're finding all this stuff that's taking place today. Where you find domestic violence is number one. And then you find that people be now is nothing but gluttonous. All they want to do is feed their flesh. Every new restaurant that's opened up, you see them lining around the building because that is that spirit that's dealing with today. Because Apostle Paul said, you're feeding your body more than you're feeding your spirit. And he's saying, guess what? He said, when you feed your spirit, he said, that's godliness and that cover all. I'm not saying that you shouldn't eat now. I'm not saying that. But I'm just saying, don't let that control you and overtake you and keep you from doing the things of the Lord. Because the Lord might come one day and say, I want you to slide the plate away. I want you to do this. I want you to do that. But if you allow your flesh to be more powerful than you hearing from the Lord to deal with sound doctrine, then you surpass what he has for you. And then when you surpass what he has for you, when he's trying to get to you, he can't get it to you to get it through you to bless you. Amen. Because guess what? You have
itching ears.
Amen. Now go to verse 17. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him. Paul said, wait a minute. What y'all doing? That's not right. He said, now I'm going to show you what's wrong because you guys have itching ears, but guess what? He said, I'm going to try to bring the doctrine to you. And when Apostle Paul tried to bring the doctrine, everywhere he went, Paul said there was a thorn given me in the flesh to come to buffet me. Some people talk about he had eye scabs and pus running from his eyes. When I was in Bible school, we searched that noise knock. Everywhere he went for preaching the gospel, some person came up against him. And even today, if you're preaching the sound doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ, people don't want to hear. They want to go somewhere so they can jump up and down and get some praise and worship. And then go home and say they fulfilled what the obligation for that day, but they don't have anything to grow thereby. When the enemy comes in, like a flood, the Lord lift up a standard against him. But if you don't have no doctrine when the enemy come in, there ain't no flood you're going to lift up.
Amen.
Praise God. Right. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Now go to verse 18. Hallelujah. Then certain philosophers of the Eucharians and of the sausage entered, encountered him. And some said, what will this blabber say? You see what he's saying? Others saw he seemed to be as a set forth of strange gods because he preached unto them what? Jesus and the resurrection. See, he preaching to them. He giving them what? Sound doctrine. The only thing that could correct itching ears, you will have to learn and receive sound doctrine. And that's what I'm trying to give you today. Amen. Look at verse 19. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine, see, whereof thou speakest is. Whereof thou speakest is. Go to verse 20. Verse 20. For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. It's in ears. We will know therefore what these things mean. What they mean? Keep going. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear of something what?
Something new.
That's what you had today. All they want to do is hear something new. Something new. You can be surprised how many people call me and talk to me about Bishop Eddie Long. I said, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. The Bible said, touch not my anointing, do my prophets no harm. Keep your mouth off God's people. I don't do that. I ain't touching nobody. I don't care what they did. I don't know the man's heart. I don't know what type of repentance he had before he died. I have no clue. So I'm not going to be the judge, because Jesus Christ said when he comes, that he going to judge the living and what? The dead. And who am I to judge anybody? Amen. I got a log in my eye trying to look at the splinter that's in your eye. I'm trying to pray and seek God how to get this big log out of mine. So but I intercede for you and we'll be together, but I ain't judging nobody. I don't have the right to judge nobody. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Because my thing is here, come, let us grow together.
Yes.
I got my own faults too. I miss it too. So why in the world I'm gonna try to correct you when I need to correct myself? Now every sermon that I get, guess what? It's for me first. Because the husband must be first partakers of the fruit. So it's for me to get me straight. And I thank God that he gave me an opportunity to allow you to be here to hear what he gave me. So maybe it might touch you in some way. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Now go to verse 22. Hallelujah. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. Too superstitious. Have you guys ever been around somebody that they're so heavenly minded that they're nowhere for good?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen somebody like that?
Yeah.
That they're so heavenly minded that they're nowhere for good? You ever seen people like that?
Yes.
And I tell you what happened to me one time is that I told this brother at church. I said, hey, brother, I said, man, that's a sharp suit you have on, man. I said, you're looking good. Well, man, you know what? I got up this morning and God told me through the Holy Ghost to put this on. And he told me to match it up with this tie, man. Amen. You know, I give God the glory because he told me what to do. I said, brother, all I want you to say good morning to. I just said good morning to you. I didn't tell you to go through all that. Amen. But see, sometimes they're so heavenly minded that don't know really good. And then you follow their lives, man, their lives in shambles.
All right.
Ain't doing nothing for God. Amen. But that's what they were here. They was too superstitious. Amen. Look at verse 23. Hallelujah. And for as I passed by and beheld your devotion, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore you eagerly worship, him declare unto you. Good God Almighty. That's what we're supposed to be doing, declaring the truth unto people who are, guess what, who misled, who don't have an understanding. Go to verse 24. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands. Good God Almighty. Go to verse 25. Neither is worship with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and in all things. Good God Almighty. Go to, keep on going to 31. And has made of one blood all nations of men, for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined the times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation. One blood and the bounds of their habitation. If you allow God to minister your life and you acknowledge him in all things, he'll tell you where to go. He'll tell you where to be. He'll tell you, praise God, guess what? He'll bless you. Because sometimes you can go a lot of other places. You go a lot of other places and guarantee you, guess what? You go places, go places, go places, and you won't be in the will of God. You won't get anything. I know I've talked to sisters who went to churches at Word of Faith. We had 25, 30,000 members. They were looking for a husband. They was there 10, 15 years, still hadn't found one. You know why? They was in the wrong place. They wasn't where God told them to be. But if you look at the Bible, it said, ask, seek, and knock. He said, you'll find. And then guess what? When they stopped looking at the church, and they were pushing a cart down the aisle at Walmart, they ran into the husband. Or was that the laundromat? Guess what? There he is. Or there she is.
But now the Bible said acknowledge him in all thy ways to direct the path. Because you think, because a person at church, you think that that person is where you're supposed to be, where you're supposed to find someone. Because a lot of times at church, people are not looking for the serve God. A lot of times people just come to hear the choir. They just come to get the music going on. They just come to pass off their business cards. They just kind of fulfill their obligation for the week and say, I've been to the church, I can feel good about myself. But if you be consistent in the things of the Lord and acknowledge him in all thy ways, he will direct your path, and I guarantee you that you'll come out with a tremendous blessing.
Amen.
Amen. Keep going, sir. I gotta keep going. That they should seek the Lord if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. He's not far from us. He's right there.
Right there.
The Bible says the word is not even our mouth, our heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. That thou confess with thy mouth, Lord Jesus Christ, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. The Bible says that you shall be saved. You shall be saved. That's what he said. Now, verse 28, I'm giving you what now? Doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm mixing itching ears with doctrine. Now, why the Bible said, for in him we live and move and have our being. As certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his what?
Offspring.
His offspring. I saw a book today talking about your destiny. There's no certain thing. Don't buy no book like that. Your destiny. Mm-hmm. That means your destiny. That's not God's destiny for you. And then you have people talking about, I did it my way. And you keep doing it your way. And then you got people too, look, I'm a self-made man. Keep it up. And don't acknowledge God. Amen. I can be all that I can be. Yeah, you can be all you can be. And the Bible said, what profit a man to gain the whole world and to lose his soul? I thought about that today. I thought about, I said, Lord, if I gain the whole world and lose my soul, that's the only thing I did is left the whole world here and end up down below and still don't have anything in a dark place all by myself in fire and nobody remembers me no more. Because I went to the graveyard, I ain't never seen anyone take no Cadillac away from me and take them suits they were split in the back. I ain't never seen nobody take none of that stuff. That's all left here. And the spirit, the real you that's on the inside of you, which you're a tripod being, you have a spirit, a soul, and you live in what?
A body.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So because only what you do for Jesus Christ is going to last.
Right.
So don't get caught up in these false doctrine, these false teaching, this is and ear stuff. Girl, come on over here. We got a good choir. Mm. Yeah. I don't come for the choir. I came for the word.
Amen.
That's going to set me free.
Amen.
The Bible
said
if you shall know the truth shall what? Make you free. I don't care how much faith you think that you have. Without knowledge, your faith will not work. Because you got to have knowledge. And then you have faith. And then after that faith, when it activates your life, then you have some wisdom.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Mm-hmm. Why do you guys think I got you reading Proverbs a chapter every day? So the Lord can fill you with wisdom.
Amen. Amen.
So when somebody comes at you with this old crazy stuff, then you say, that ain't God.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. I'm going to teach you everything I can. Everything I learned in Bible school, I'm going to give it to you. In these 20, 25 years I've been in the ministry, I'm going to give you everything I got. Amen. Pray. I paid for it, but I'm giving you free. Because the Bible said, freely you receive, freely you what? You give. Amen. All right, verse 29. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's devices. That means don't put nothing else before God. Don't put no car before God. Don't put your wife before God. Don't put your husband before God. Don't put your job before God. Don't put no materialistic thing before God. And I'm going to share some things with you. I don't know if I got enough time. Go to verse 30. And the times of this ignorance God winked at. He winked at it before. It's time now for you to leave milk. Mm-hmm. And it's time for you now to go to meat. He winked at it in time past. Because you were just born again. You didn't know. Now it's time for us to grow up.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Because he's not going to wink at it anymore. Amen. Now, if your 50-year-old son came home and wee-wee in the floor, what would you think? But when he was 3 or 4 years old, it's all right.
Mm-hmm.
You say, all right, son, you know, you clean it up, you know, change. But if a 50-year-old come over there, man, we got a problem.
Amen.
Isn't that right? We got a major problem, don't we? Don't we have a major problem?
Yes, sir.
Amen. So now, guess what? We're no more infants in God anymore. We're adults, and the Lord is looking for different things from us. You can't continuously doing the same thing you did 20 years ago.
Amen.
Now you have to look, grow up and follow the doctrine, teaching the Lord, and begin to do what he told you to do.
There you go. There
Amen?
You go. Yes, sir.
Verse 31. But he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained, whereof he has given assurance unto all men that in that he has raised him from the dead. Because he's calling now for every person to repent. That means repent, that means change your mind. Change your mindset.
Yeah.
Stop going in that same direction. Now right now, if we leave here and say that we're going to Memphis, Tennessee, and we get on 55 and head south, I don't care how long you argue, how long you talk about, how long you drive, we're not going to get to Memphis.
That's right.
We end up way down on the Gulf Coast, but we're not going to get to Memphis. Uh-uh. So you got to turn around and go the right way.
Turn it around.
Amen. Praise God.
All right.
I made mistakes like that, man. Constance said, honey, that ain't the right way. I'll tell you, I know where I'm going. She said, that's not the right way. You can't get there from here. I'm driving. You just sit over there and be cool. Then after I got down and looked all funny in the face and shame, I said, turn. She said, what you doing? I said, I'm going to make a little turn up in here. You know, I'm going to make sure my tire's all right. Oh, I think I'm going to roll a little bumper right here. I think I'm going to go that way. She look at me. So if you're going the wrong way, brother. Just hold up to it, stop, repent, and go the right way. Amen?
That's right.
Amen. Praise God.
Life.
Now, I'm going to read this to you. People want to hear what they desire to hear and prefer to hear and not necessarily what God has to say about the matter. God understands. God knows your heart. That hears you sleep with everybody in town, right? God knows my heart. He knows my heart. He knows a man that I got needs. He said, I'm God, I change not. I'm the same yesterday, today, forever. He said, no, that's not my doctrine, that's not my teaching. God did not put it in the Bible just to say something, to have something to say. He put it in the scriptures so we can have something that we can live by and have a holy life. Amen. I'm going to read you something in a minute. Now go to Jude chapter 16, verse 20. 16 to 21. And I'm going to have to close with this. I couldn't get to where I want to get today. Jude chapter 16, verse 20 to 21. Man, I couldn't get to where I want to get today. Jude 16, verse 16 to 21. Jude, verse 16 to 21. Mm-hmm. Okay, here we go. He said, this is what he said, it's his. These are murmurers, complainers, walking out their own lust, and their mouth speaks great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of what?
Advantage.
Oh man, I got to do this, man. Because I'm going to give me a raise. I got to do this, man, because I had this. But leaving away from the principles of God. Go to verse 17. But beloved, remember, ye the words which were spoken before of the apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, put me in remembrance. Remember these things. Verse 18. How that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, who shall walk after their own ungodly lust. Of their own ungodly lust. Look at verse 19. These be they who separate themselves sensual, having not the spirit. Go to verse 20. But ye, beloved, build up yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Go to verse 21. Keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto what?
Eternal life.
Eternal life. That's what we seek. In order to receive eternal life, to operate eternal life, yeah, you can work hard and get what you want. You can get your education, you can work hard, you can be diligent. But guess what? You can have all those things. But the blessings of the Lord come without sorrows.
Yes.
I've seen many people at General Motors that work in jobs making big money was totally unhappy. Hated to come to work. And when they got off work, guess what they did? They stopped by bars and got high before they went home.
Mm.
Because they hated what they was doing. But whatever God tells you to do, he has no sorrows.
Amen.
And it's a pleasure thing. You enjoy it. And guess what? Promotions come from up above. And God wants to open his hands because he said, whatever door I have opened, no man can close. And whatever door I've closed, no man can open. He said, I've laid a straight way, a straight path before you. He said, all you have to do is just enter in. I did the work. He said, the only thing you have to do is just walk. Walk in it and receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to read you this, and then I'm going to quit. I got a lot of scriptures that I'm going to jump over a little bit. And I want you, saints, do not compromise. Don't compromise. Do not compromise. The word compromise, do not trade off or accept standards that are lower than is desirable. Now, Samson, he compromised and lost his anointing and lost his life. Samson did. Because he compromised. He didn't follow the doctrine of what God had told him to do. I'm going to be done in a minute. King Saul, he compromised and lost his throne and lost his standing with God. King Saul did because he compromised. David compromised and lost his son. And still today, when you talk about David, it always comes up. He was a man after God's own heart, but guess what he did? He had somebody to kill to take his wife. And long as there be history, long as there be life, that's always going to be talked about by David. About David. If you compromise, the enemy is always going to bring you to shame. Amen. Lot's wife, she compromised and was turned into sand. Salt, I'm sorry, turned into salt when she compromised. She was turned into salt. And the Bible said that if people hadn't picked away, the weather hadn't picked away, you go and see it, it would be still standing there. Because she lost her life. Because she was looking back for the desires of Sodom and Gomorrah. But in that city, all you had was lesbians and all you had was homosexuals that tried to rape down the angels of the Lord. Isn't that crazy? The man offered up his daughter. They said, we don't want them. We want the ones who came. We want the men. I can see it right now. We want them men right there. And the angel of the Lord grabbed Lot and pulled him in the house. Guess what he did? And then threw up his hand and then blinded all the men in the city. And said they went away from him because they couldn't see himself. You can't mess with God. Judas compromised and lost his position with Jesus and hung himself. Peter compromised and cursed and denied Jesus, what? Three times. All he had to do was say, yes, I know him.
Yeah.
It's better to die and say, I know him. Than to die and say, I don't know it.
Mm.
Like a guy told me one day, he said, how do you know everything you read?